Okay, welcome everyone. Lecture 8, Introduction to Order Theory. We continue today with our families of posets that have unbounded dimension and are interesting for many perpendicular properties that they do have. I think today we will finish this list we have. And then perhaps we will have a look at the next section, which is some interplay between dimension and planarity properties of posets. So the family I want to start with today are adjacency posets, and this is yet another. This is discussion on yet another operator that's given a graph gives us a poset. And if G is a graph, what we can do is we can get its adjacency poset, which we denote by AG. And then what is it? Yeah. So it has if our graph has n vertices, then the poset has 2n elements. And now a vertex here is somehow corresponds to an incomparable pair here, which we can denote by AB and BB. These are two elements of the poset, and they are incomparable. And in a poset, whenever we have an edge UV in the graph, on the poset side, we have four corresponding elements here. Yeah, AU, BU, AV, and BV. And the relation we see, and that are imposed by definition, are these two. AU is below BV, and AV is below BU in the adjacency poset of our graph G. Yeah? So that's the definition. And then as usually, we discuss it because it has non-trivial dimension. So for every graph G, we have that dimension of its adjacency poset is at least the chromatic number of the graph itself. And this has a fairly easy proof, but maybe before we prove it, let's note here that we can have a non-trivial examples here in this family. So first of all, whenever G has an edge, if G just has an edge, then if this immediately gives you a standard example of size 2 in the adjacency poset, yeah? But now, if we take a graph that doesn't have a triangle, so there's no click on size 3, then we will never see a standard example of size 3, yeah? So if G is triangle 3, then we know that AG is now S3. So in other words, the standard example number of AG is at most 2. Yeah. So yet, together with this proposition here, and with a well-known fact that there are triangle, three graphs, or arbitrary large chromatic number, we get a family of posets with no large standard examples and arbitrary large dimension. Yeah. We even get something more, because on the side of graphs there is yet a stronger property, that you can get a large chromatic number not only that when you're triangle free, but even when you have a large girth. And this, not this girth thing, so girth is the minimum size of a cycle in the graph. Yeah. So when G has girth G, then we get that the adjacency poset, actually not the poset itself, but its cover graph, it's a height two poset, so it coincides with a comparability graph. So say a comparability graph of AG has girth. And now what is the girth there? Does it coincide? Is it G always? I think it's even at least G. Maybe it could be longer. Yeah. But the easy observation here is that when you have large curve here, then you have large curve here. That is the only construction that I know of posets that have that their comparability graphs have large curve and they have a large dimension. It's absolutely non-trivial to get it in any other way. So let's move to the proof now that gives us this leverage, so that we are able to transmit large chi to large dimension. And how do we prove it? So consider any realizer. Realizer of our poset G, yeah? And then we want from the realizer of size D, we want to have a coloring with D colors. How do we get it? So when we have a vertex D in the graph G, we can look at its corresponding incomparable pair AV, BV. Yeah, it's an incomparable pair in the adjacency poset. And now since this is a realizer, this pair is reversed in one of the linear extensions. So choose I in 1 to D such that BV is less than AV in L. Maybe it would be consistent with the previous stuff I did, choose alpha in L alpha. Yes, and actually we can define this way some function, yeah, FV equals alpha, yeah. And the claim is just that this is a proper coloring of a graph, yeah. So claim, phi is a proper coloring of G, and this should be quite immediate. So proof of the claim take UV adjacent in the graph, then as we seen from the definition, in the poset we have this structure, AU, BU, AV, BD, and now say that phi of u is equal alpha, yeah? Can it be that phi of v is alpha as well? Well, phi of u is alpha, this by the definition means that in alpha, bu, au bu is reversed, yeah? So this is what we see in L alpha. But au is below bv in the poset. And so it must be in its linear extension L alpha, yeah? And bu is above av in the poset, so it must be in linear extension as well. But this means that AB, BB per is not reversed in L alpha. So this means that the color of B is not alpha as desired. Okay, so we know that phi is a proper color ring. We use D colors where D was the size of a realizer we started with. So this indeed proves the inequality. We move on to next family, but before that, let me take an opportunity to give you another useful concept, which we will use starting the next family, but it's it should appear recurrently and over our course. So it's a notion of critical pair. A critical pair. So, well, we have a poset, and then in this poset, an incomparable pair. Is critical if we have the following two properties. For every element z in the poset, if z is less than x, then z in V, then z is less than y. And if y is less than z, then x is less than z. Okay. Let's have a look. What does it mean? So, a critical pair as an incomparable pair is ordered. So there is a first element and a second element in the pair. And when it's critical, it somewhat looks like this. Like x is somewhat lower, though incomparable with y. And why do I see it this way? So look, so the first item says that when you look at the downset of x, you take any element that is strictly below x, z, then this element is below y as well, yes? So, yeah? And even more, when you look at any element here, w, yeah? That is above y, strictly above y, yes? Then it's also above x itself, yeah? This is a critical pair. Now, the importance of this concept comes from a simple idea that it's enough to reverse critical pairs to reverse all the pairs. And this will come as in our next proposition. Let's denote by crit P to be the set of all critical pairs So the position let P be a poset. R be a family of linear extensions. Of P. Then the following two are equivalent. But this is not the equivalence we wanted to talk about. This would be equivalent with the thing that R reverses all pairs in this set. So this is an easy proof, but the proof of a nice concept. Which pair is actually responsible? Which critical pair is responsible for the pair you want to, you have in mind to reverse? Let's have a look. So obviously, one of the directions is trivial. So one plus two is trivial. So we just look at the direction two implies one. And so in order to do it, we need to consider an incomparable pair xy, and when we need to find a linear extension in R that reverses this pair. So how do we do it? So here's our x, here's our y, and we first look at the bounces of x, and you can say that we go with the following algorithm, that we start in an element x itself, and as long as there is z below x prime in P, such that z is incomparable with y, take x prime, set x prime to be z. Yeah. So as long as you make a move and you're still incomparable with your element at the top, you continue. Yeah. And then at some point, you arrive here with the x prime, and there is no move, yeah? So all the downsets here, which could be empty, I mean, yeah? There could be no element strictly below x prime. This is fine. Is below y. And then we do the same thing from the other side, yeah? So we set up y prime to be y, and as long as there is z which is greater than y prime in P, such that z is incomparable with x prime. Take y prime to be z. Yeah? So we move in the opposite direction, and as long as we can make a move that, and we stay incomparable with this element, we make this move. Yeah? And then eventually we arrive to y prime, and there is no other move. So now what you need to observe is that x prime y prime is an incomparable pair, is actually a critical pair. Yeah. And another thing you should keep in mind is that x prime is less or equal than x, and y is less or equal than y prime in P. So now, from the assumptions of the second item, there is a linear extension in R that reverses x prime y prime. So there is a linear extension that y prime is below x prime in L, yeah? But x prime is less or equal than x in the poset, so it must be in a linear extension, and y is less or equal than y prime. So this means that L reverses x, y as desired. So indeed, in order to have a realizer, all we have to do is reverse critical pairs. Okay. So now we are conceptually ready for another family, which is generalized grounds. Generalized because perhaps we already introduced in the lecture or in exercises concept of a crown. What was it? Yeah. No? Oh. Yeah, that would be only a fence. Yes. So a generalized crown will generalize this concept, and it will also cover standard examples themselves. So here it is. So we talk about integers. Two parameters, n that is greater or equal than 3 and k that is greater or equal than 0. And then the crown skm, or maybe I should say snk, is height to poset with minimal elements A1, AN plus K, and maximal elements V1 Bn plus k. So in general, we have two n plus k elements. No. Such that for each I n one up to n plus k, we have the following: that bi is incomparable with ai, ai plus 1 up to ai plus k, and is above all the other i's. So bi is greater than aj whenever j is in the set. And now I should write I plus k plus 1 up to I plus k plus n minus 1. So obviously, all the indices here are taken cyclically. Let's draw it. Yeah. Yes, so n is 4, k is 2. So how many elements do we have? We have 6 minimal elements and 6 maximal elements, yes? Indices are taken cyclically, so modulo n plus k, where instead of a zero we prefer to have a six. B1 B6. Now. What do we have now? B1 is incomparable with k plus 1 elements, yeah? Yeah? So each B is incomparable with k plus 1 elements. K is 2, so this B is incomparable with these three elements here, starting from its own index forward. And it's above the other. Yeah. B2 is incomparable with these three elements, and it's above the other. B3 B4 B5 and B6. Oh. So I must have this. Thank you. Yeah. So this is a S42. And so in general, you should note that SN0 should be exactly a standard example of size n, because we have n plus 0 minimal elements, n plus 0 maximal elements, and each maximal element is incomparable with k plus 1 other elements, so 0 plus 1. This gives a standard example, right? And so it's not a surprise this time that the dimension grows, yeah, that it's possibly unbounded, yeah, with growing n. What is satisfying here, I think, is that we actually have the precise formula for the dimension, yeah. I realize now that I wanted to state it later, but if I already have the proposition, I should do the statement. Yes. So for all n greater or equal 3 and k greater or equal 0, we have that the dimension of S n k is exactly 2 times n plus k over k plus 2 c. And since we are in this mood that we are more about lower bounds for dimension here, we want to somewhat saturate with possible arguments how to approach this. This is the part we will show in details. But it is interesting that this will be actually tight. We will see a glimpse of the argument from the upper bound. Actually the key insight to get this proposition can be stated as an independent thing. So let L be a linear extension of SNK. Then this linear extension reverses at most k plus 2, choose 2 critical pairs in S and k. Okay, so if we mention critical pairs in this specific family, we should understand where are they, and there are not too many incomparable pairs themselves in the picture, so you can obviously look at an incomparable pair with A and B. And they are critical immediately, right? Because everything which is strictly below A is below B, and everything which is strictly above B is above A. That is fine, yes? And if you look at incomparable pairs, say, on this level, yeah, so XY would be here, then this is not critical. This is not critical because you can find something above this, which is still not above this. And this is simply because for any two elements here, their upsets are distinct. So you can find an element which does the job. And it will somewhat shift your incomparable pair to a more difficult one. Yeah? So what I'm saying here is that the critical pairs of S and K are the incomparable pairs of S and K intersected with A cross B, where A is the set of mins and B is the set of maxes. Okay. So with this in mind, we can approach the proof here of the lemma. So we have a linear extension, yeah? And within this linear extension, we want to look at its restriction to the maximal elements, yeah? So this gives us some, since the maximal elements are just form an integer, obviously, any permutation is actually an option, yeah? So I put indices and superscripts just to indicate that this is a different enumeration, yeah? Yeah, so this is how it looks like in L. Now the other elements, so the minimal elements, are somewhat here in between the stuff, yeah. And so for each B, yeah, we can count the number of A's that are right, so above in the linear extension. Yeah, so number of A in A, such that BI is less than A in L. And from this, it is clear that that L reverses exactly WL BI, yeah? Critical pairs, I goes from 1 to n plus k. Yeah? Now if we cannot go with an A too far to the right, because every element A, yeah, A is a minimal element, yeah, so it's easy to put it on the left, yeah, but if you push it to the right, you have to watch out to not get over something that you should be below. When we just think about B's, then a single A is incomparable to exactly K plus 1 B's. So there is no A that can be pushed over more than K plus 1 B's here, yeah? So what I'm saying is that WL BI is equal to 0 when I is greater than k plus 1. Greater equal, we could say, k plus 2. Yes. This means that here we can put k plus 1. Yes. And now we will conclude with the following claim that the actual number we look at here is at most k plus 1, okay, let it be k plus 2 minus I. And this is true for every I from 1 to k plus 1. Yeah, so a sanity check, we can quickly see that this is okay for I equals 1. For I equals 1, we consider a number of A's that go over the first B. And there we know that this B is incomparable to exactly K plus 1 minimal elements. So that's all that you can put above it, yeah? So immediately you get here a bound k plus 1, so it works for I equals 1, yeah? But here we want to set up an argument for all the values of I. Yeah, so here LBI is at most the size of all the A's that are incomparable with B1, and this is exactly K plus 1. Yeah? For a general argument, let's consider A's in their natural cyclic order. So please note that this break here is completely artificial and it's just connected with the way we draw it. Yeah, there is nothing special about the first or the last pair. That's why this will be convenient to look at it in a cyclic fashion. Now, what do we do is when we look at the single B, yeah, a single element B, then it's incomparable to exactly k plus 1 elements. These k plus 1 elements form an interval in our order, yeah? So you can think of it as an arc here, yeah? So that could be some incomparable element, let me denote it by I of some B, yes? Now, if we think about WLBI, then we are interested in the intersection of intervals BJ for J from 1 to I. Yeah, because these are the elements that possibly could go over all the B's. So clearly this is an uppermost here. Now, okay, so how to put our hands on it? So if this, well, wait a second. Is it okay? Yes, it's okay. So so we want to put an unbounded actually on this, yes? And so if this set is empty, then obviously we are fine. If it's not empty, then take anything from there. So take A star, which is in the intersection. This will be kind of our anchor, yeah? So here is A star, yeah? And now, A star is in each of the intervals. So take the interval which reaches most to the clockwise direction from A star, yeah? There is a clockwise direction, yeah? These intervals could be really big, actually. Almost everything, yes? It's not everything because N is non-zero, yeah? There is a little space, but they could be really big, yeah? And this is the one among all these that reaches most in the clockwise direction. And now, so this one here contains k plus 1 elements, yes? Now think about the next interval, the one that reaches slightly less, yeah? Well, okay, let me draw it here. Now, what I want to argue is that this element, which is immediately after, is out of the intersection, yes? This one. And then I take the next one, yeah? And this element will be out of the intersection and it's distinct from this one. Yeah? Remember that that they could cycle here and suddenly they overlap here again. So this might be slightly confusing. But still, the highlighted yellow elements are taken out of the intersection. Now, how many yellow elements do I have? I start with a single interval, and then for each next one, I have a yellow element. So, so I can bound the intersection with the size of the first interval, which is k plus 1, and then I subtract a number of my intervals minus 1, so I minus 1, which is the bound we want to prove. Okay. So we proved our claim, and the claim should prove the lemma because as we discussed, the number of things being reversed is just the sum of WLBI, I equals 1 to k plus 1. Now we know that this is at most sum I equals 1 to k plus 1 of k plus 2 minus I. This is the same as sum of 1 to k plus 1, right? And this is exactly binomial coefficient, yes, as desired. Okay, so we know that when we take a linear extension, there is a bound on the number of things we can reverse. And this logic immediately gives a lower bound on dimension, right? Now we have to just put the numbers together. So let's do it. Proof of the proposition. Lower bound. So, how many critical pairs do we have? Well, there are n plus k. There are n plus k maximal elements. Each maximal element is incomparable with k plus 1 minimal elements. Yeah? Each linear extension reverses at most k plus 1 times k plus 2 over 2 critical pairs. So we conclude that the dimension of S and K is at least number over this number. Yeah, and since dimension is an integer, we can put this here. Yeah, so this is exactly the claim. Bound. Okay, so that's nice. That's some number. I don't know what is the feel of about the proof. How generous we were on the way. But it turns out that this is tight. And let me just show you one of the cases for the upper bound. Let's look at the case when n plus k is, well, in general, in upper bound constructions, so constructions of the realizer, we want to look at the n plus k, which is the number of minimals or maximals, as some multiple of k plus 2, the thing we have in the denominator. And obviously, there might be some remainder. And I want to have a quick look with you on the case r equals 0. So in r equals 0, the claimed number size of the realizer is exactly 2q. Oops, 2q. So what we do here is the following. We take any consecutive BIs, consecutive on in a circular order, and construct any consecutive BIs. Let me be more precise. Consecutive set of k plus 2 maximal elements let's call it B prime, yeah? Subset of B. And then for this thing we want to construct two linear extensions. Let's call it L and L prime, such that I reverse all critical pairs, all incomparable pairs. In all the minimals versus B prime. Yeah, so what is happening here? We think about our generalized ground, yeah, set of maximal elements of size n plus k. We put it into chunks of size k plus 2, yeah? The number of chunks is exactly q. And for each chunk, yeah, we will consider, without loss of generality, just the chunk b1 up to b k plus 2. We will consider two linear extensions. We will construct two linear extensions such that they reverse all the pairs, all the incomparable pairs that involves these elements. These elements against all the minimal elements. Okay, so if we realize what should be done, this is actually a very universal remark. If you realize what should be done, it becomes easy. So what do we do? So in L, we take B1 less than A1 less than B2 less than A2, and then BK minus 1, AK minus 1, BK, AK, BK plus 1, AK plus 1. And in L prime, yeah, maybe let's support it with a drawing. B2, BK plus 1, BK plus 2. That's all the B's we are interested in. Now we should look where are the incomparable pairs, yeah? So this B is incomparable with all the A's up to this one, yeah? And this B, which is last in our chunk, is incomparable with all the A's from AK plus 2 up to 2K plus 2. Right? So here's what it's done. Yeah, B1 is already reversed with everything it wants to be. So actually, I put here some elements of the generalized crown. It is a linear extension of this subposet. You put all the rest as you like. You can always extend a linear extension of a subposet to a linear extension of the full poset. And the order of other elements is not important as long as it respects the poset. So B1 is happy already because B1 is reversed. All the pairs with B1 are reversed here, yeah? And BK plus 2 is not even present here, but it's unhappy, yeah? It's not reversed. So here we put BK plus 2 first, and now we want to have the A's, and the A's are also put in the reversed order to the, wait, 2k plus 1. Before ak plus 4, b3, ak plus 3, b2, ak plus 2. Okay, so you can look, for example, what happens with B2, yeah? B2 is incomparable with A2 and all the stuff up to AK plus 2. Here, in this linear extension, it is reversed with everything except the last AK plus 2. And this is exactly what is done in the second linear extension, where B2 is just put below AK plus 2. Yeah? So somewhat you see that for each B, the incomparable pairs are put into two intervals, and one of them is reversed in L and the other in L prime. Okay, so this completes the proof of an upper bound in this in the case when the remainder is zero. The other cases are not really more complex, but they are also not interesting. So we skip them, and with this we somewhat close the section on families of posets with unbounded dimension and usually bounded size of a standard example, I guess except the last family where this was growing together. I have here one interesting
remark
at the end. So so we call a hypergraph of the poset. Yeah. So the vertices were the incomparable pairs, and edges were alternating cycles. Now we consider colorings, yeah, proper colorings, and we know that given the poset is not a chain, yeah, so. This all stands and dimension of the poset is exactly the chromatic number of its hypergraph. Now, from what we said already, we know that instead of all incomparable pairs, we could just look at the critical pairs. And instead of all the hyper edges, we just could look at all alternating cycles, we could just look at the strict alternating cycles, yeah? This doesn't change the game. Then, in this like a core hypergraph, the obvious definition of a click number coincides with a standard example number of the poset. Yeah. And so there is the obvious inequality here, right? Dimension is greater or equal than the size of standard example in the poset, yeah? As much as chromatic number is greater or equal than the click number. And we know that there are classes of posets where one is bounded and the other explodes. There is an interesting parameter here sandwiched between these two. And this is something I like to call chi2 of a hypergraph. So chi2 of the hypergraph is a chromatic number of the hypergraph, the subgraph, where the only edges you look at are of size 2. Yeah. So you have your incomparable pairs here, but now you consider only alternating cycles of size 2. Yeah. That is still above the click number because the click is defined as the larger click in this graph actually, yeah? And that is clearly below chromatic number itself, which you could look at as chi infinity, yeah? Because you consider all the edges of all sizes, yeah? So this parameter is sandwiched in between, and believe me, or not, but we do not know if we can bound dimension in terms of chi2. I guess no one believes that this could be bounded. And it would simplify some research projects and some proofs written if we would know it, if it's just enough to look at the two cycles. But we don't know. So here is a formal statement of this. This is perhaps the first problem I want to celebrate with you. This we could give a nickname as chi2 versus chi infinity, and then is there a function f such that for every poset, P, we have that dimension of P, so chi infinity, yes, is bounded by a function of chi 2 of the hypergraph, yeah? Is chi infinity bounded by a function of chi 2? All we know is that if this function exists, it must be exponential, at least. And this is subject of the next proposition. So for every integer t, let's put it greater or equal to, there is a poset pt with chi 2 of the hypergraph pt at most 3t. And dimension of P at least 1.5 t to the minus 1. Okay. Okay. So let's have a quick look. Construction. So P2 is just a free cycle. And the PT plus 1 is constructed from free copies of PT, So this is Q1, Q2, Q3, and you put all the minimal elements of Q1 below maxes of Q2, all the minimal elements of Q2 below maxes of Q3, and all the minimal elements of Q3 below the maxes of Q1. That's the construction. Now you notice that, you can notice that here the chi2 of P2 is around 2, and you notice that you want to keep by induction actually. That there is a set of critical pairs of 3 to the t minus 1 critical pairs. In PT, such that no linear extension reverses more than 2 to the t minus 1 of them. So at the beginning, for P2, our set of three to the 2 minus 1, so 3 incomparable pairs are just these vertical pairs here. You have 3 critical pairs, and no linear extension reverses more than 2 of them, because if you want to reverse all the 3, you want to reverse an alternating cycle, and that is not possible. So we have the base. Here the base says that, that it's less than 3t, which is 2 is less than 6, And then what we do is that that we want to carry it over here. So this item is done because, look, we have in each of these blocks, we have these sets. Yeah. So this is p to the t plus 1. So here we have 3 to the t minus 1 in comparable pairs here, 3 to the t minus 1 in comparable pairs here, and 3 to the t minus 1 in comparable pairs here. I take them all. Yeah. This is 3 times 3 to the t minus 1 critical pairs. Yeah. In our new poset. And I claim that no linear extension reverses more than 2 to the t minus, 2 to the, this is 3 to the t, and no linear extension here of pt plus 1 reverses more than 2 to the t. Why is it so? Well, first note that no linear extension reverses a pair from here, and a pair from here, and a pair from here. Because whatever are the positions, yeah, this forms a free cycle. So in order to, you can reverse at most pairs from at most 2 blocks. Yeah. So all you can do is you can revert 2 times the number of pairs in each block, but that by induction is 2 to the t minus 1. So you can reverse at most 2 to the t out of 3 to the t. And this is the item we want to carry by induction. The first item, which should be, yeah, that chi, this should be actually that chi 2 of h pt is less or equal than 3t, yeah? This is okay because now here we can use 3t colors, the same 3t colors here and the same 3t colors here to color the hypergraph inside here, and inside here. We color the critical pairs there. Now the thing we need to observe is that the coloring is proper so far. Then this is true because when you take a critical pair from here and a critical pair from here, it cannot close a two-cycle. You can have one comparability, but you don't have the other, yeah, because this goes there. So indeed you can reuse the colors. And now all we need to do is to color the remaining critical pairs. And the remaining critical pairs are of the type x, y, yeah? Where x is in qi, and y is in, or x is in qi plus 1, and y is in qi, yeah? That's the stuff that is remaining. And in order to do that, we just use 3 extra colors for the 3 shifts, yeah? This is color 1, this is color 2, this is color 3. And pairs within one color, hopefully, yeah, they don't even have a single comparability across. So this proves that that we can use 3T plus 3 colors, yeah, on the chi 2 hypergraph of pt plus 1, yeah, which closes the proof of this item and closes the construction, because I'm sure you immediately see that this item drives dimension to be these. This is okay. This is nice. It's a fascinating open problem. I'm hopeful we can resolve it in some near future. Somewhat. It's embarrassing, yeah, if you want to do dimension theory, this is the first thing you should check, yeah? And that's open. And when someone does it, everyone said, yeah, that was clear. But So with this remark, I'm moving to the next section, which is the interplay between dimension and planarity. I will make a proper introduction to it, starting with the next lecture. So here, today, this is, if I got the numbers right, three dimensional planarity. And today, let me just quickly jump into the business, and let's consider the following proposition. Let P be a poset. With a planar diagram. That has a unique minimal element, which we call a zero, and a unique maximal element. Is called usually a 1. Then such a poset has dimension at most 2. Okay, so let's see. We do dimension, we want to understand how the incomparable pairs look like. Well, maybe it's healthy if I start with a drawing of an object, how does it look like, yeah? So I'm not sure I can quickly draw what I have here, but who cares if it's exactly the same or not. Yeah, pretty symmetric, but let it be. This is 0, this is 1. Okay, these animals have dimension at most 2, and as long as they have an incomparable pair, they have a dimension exactly 2. Why is it so? Well, for an incomparable pair, in such a poset, we say that X is left of Y if there is a maximal chain. So a chain from 0 to 1, saturated, yeah? Going through Y so that X is left of it. Of the chain. Now, I should clarify what I mean here, but this is fairly natural. This is 0, this is 1, and here is a chain that goes through Y. Yeah. Now, x is somewhere. Definitely, it's not on the chain, because x and y are incomparable. So it's, and then because we have a 0 and 1, we have a clear cut of the plane in the left side and the right side, yeah? So if x is here, it's left of y. And if x is here, it's right of y, okay? Oh, yes, yes, obviously. That's actually a good point. We should fix the diagram. Thank you. Fix the diagram of P. Yeah. Okay. So, with this... definition, I like to call all the pairs that are left, I left, yeah? That's a set of pairs that x is left of y, and the same I write, yeah? Now, you can find this definition dangerous, because it depends on the chain, and at the moment maybe a pair is left and the pair is right, yeah. But this is not what is happening here in this beautiful scenario of a planar diagram 0 and 1. So if you have a pair which is left, then this is by definition there exists a maximal chain going through y. Such that x is left of the chain. Yeah? But this is actually equivalent that with for all maximal chains going through y, x is left of the chain. And this requires some proof. There is one interesting direction. This implies this, yeah? So let's look at the proof of it. So, consider a pair that is left. Consider a chain that witnesses the thing, yeah? And now, okay. Now, let's suppose the opposite, that this is not true. So suppose there is a chain that goes through y that puts x right of it. Yeah? What does it mean that x is right of the chain, actually? Yeah? Well, you can think of it as there is a horizontal line going through x. And now this chain should hit x here, so it's x is right. Yeah? Well, that's actually nice, right? So now this chain goes, this red chain, starts from 0, goes to 1, goes through y. Follow the chain, starting from the horizontal line, and look at the first moment it hits your first chain, yeah? And the same from this direction. Look at the first moment it hits your chain. Then it can wiggle, but I don't really care about the rest of the picture, yeah? We have an x which is closed in some kind of lens, and then the general thing about this picture is that when you look that y is here in this section or here, yeah, because the red chain hits y, So it can't be that y is on this part of the white chain. Yes? Okay. So in my picture, y is on the top part. Since y is at the top part, I want to recall that actually x is below 1. Now, let's go for it. Yeah? How do you do it? Well, you have to cross one of the chains. What happens when you cross one of the chains? Well, you make x less than 1, which is a contradiction. Okay. So, a pair is left. It means that all the chains going through y leave x on the left. Yet another useful observation is that if a pair is left, then the dual of it, so yx, is actually right. Well, this also needs an argument, but it's fairly the same, right? So, what do we do? So this is again y. So this is witnessing that xy is left, yeah? Now we're thinking about a chain going through x, and to get a contradiction, I'm trying to prove this implication again, yeah? And to find a contradiction, I want to consider a possibility that my red chain going through x leaves y on the left. So I'm starting from here, and I want to hit this line here. Yeah? Well, clearly, I want to cross the white chain. But when I cross it, I realize I have a problem. In my picture, it is x below y. This is dependent on the picture. It could be that y is less than x if I have chosen y to be below in the y-axis of the diagram. Okay, this proves this implication. The other implication, obviously, is symmetric. Okay. Very nice. So we are somewhat ready to conclude. All we need to observe is that I left is transitive. That's an interesting claim. Let's give it a try. So xy and yz is I left. Now, let's digest the situation here. So we have a 0, we have a 1. I would like to draw any chain going through y. Okay? This is my chain. Now, xy is left. This means that x is left of this chain. Yeah? So x is somewhere, say, here. Yz is left, but this means that zy is right. And since zy is right, this means that z is left right of this chain. Okay? There are two things we need to show. First thing is that actually xz is incomparable. I guess we could make it concise in one argument, but this is not given. So we have to argue that. And well, that's clear what is going to happen. X is on one side, z is on the other side. Let's go. We go. We cross the white chain. Y is on one of the sides, and depending on which side is it, it's either that X is below Y, but if Y would be here, then Y would be below Z. Both of them are not happening. This means that indeed it's incomparable. So now, how about XZ being left? Well, what would happen if it's right? If XZ is right, then you want to consider a chain going through Z. that leaves X right of it. That's even difficult to imagine, but this chain, that the blue chain that goes through Z, wants to hit X horizontal line here. Well, clearly we were talking about two sides of the white chain. So in order to complete it, we need to cross it. When we cross it, Yes. So here we don't have a, because why would we on this side would have comparability? Somewhat in my drawing, in the notes, I finished the proof already. But why could be on this side? And then we still are in the game, but now x is below 1, and it's embedded in this cone. So in order to get to 1, you see we have a planar diagram with a 1. Then we need to hit one of the chains, and then we make. And this now it's important that we are in the case that y is actually on this side of the white chain, yeah. And yes, we get the comparability which is not there. So it's a contradiction of our assumptions that it wasn't left. So it is left. Okay. So this is like a conclusion because. What do we have? Incomparabilities of P are I left union I right. Actually, I left is just I right dual. And and then we know that I left, so I right is as well is transitive. So what we know is that we take a poset P, we look at its comparability graph, we take a dual, and we realize that its dual can be made transitive. So it's a comparability graph again. This is exactly the property of a two-dimensional poset, forcing poset to be two-dimensional, yes? This closes the argument. What you would like to observe actually is what are the two linear extensions perhaps, yes? And there is a nice way of seeing it. You can read it with a generic algorithm. And so a generic algorithm will always start with a zero, and then it's about the preference you want to make. So the preference is somewhat you want to read it. In one linear extension, you want to read it left to right. Now, what does it mean? Let me show you. Yeah. So this would be one, not that one, but another one. This would be two. This is three. This is four. I cannot take it. This is five, six, seven, eight. Yeah. Now. Okay, let's look at here, yeah? This is the generic algorithm situation, yeah? Now we are about to take 9. What are the candidates, yeah? This is not a candidate, this is a candidate. Yo. This is a candidate, and this is a candidate. Minimal elements in the current poset. Minimal elements by definition are form an antichain. This antichain is ordered in a yes, is ordered by our I left, for example, or I right, yeah? So it's a total ordering here. So we have something which is leftmost or rightmost, but we intuitively know which one is the leftmost here. So to make it formal from this side, you would consider that you're taking some blob, and this is like some connected shape in the plane. And then from this blob, there are edges, you leave it, yeah, with edges, yeah? And since at the beginning you have a clear cut, and you can read it in this direction, you always know which one is first. Okay, that is a nice proof in a situation of a planar diagram. We'll have lots more fun to come with planarity. But this is in the next episode. Thank you.